Hello, my dear students. Today we shall be talking about an important topic in cardiovascular system, that is systemic hypertension. As we all know, hypertension is very commonly seen past middle age. It is often asymptomatic. It can easily be detected. It can be treated also to a very great extent. And but if you don't treat this particular disease, it can definitely lead to somewhat lethal complications. So it is important to understand that this is not a disease per se. It's only a symptom, and if it is controlled at the right point of time, definitely we can save a valuable life. On this note, let's talk about hypertension. Hypertension is a condition in which arterial blood pressure is chronically elevated. Since blood pressure occurs within a continuous range, so cutoff levels are defined according to the effect on the patient's risk. Hypertension could be that level of blood pressure at or above which long-term antihypertensive treatment will reduce or bring down cardiovascular mortality. The 7th report of Joint National Committee and WHO and International Society of Hypertension guidelines have defined it to be more than 140 mm of mercury systolic and 90 mm of mercury diastolic, though risk even appears when the blood pressure is above 120 to 80. Now this is the JNC 7th committee classification which has been given. If the systolic blood pressure is less than 120 and the diastolic blood pressure is less than 80, we call it a normotensive person. Prehypertension, when the systolic blood pressure lies within the range of 120 to 139 and diastolic lies within the range of 80 to 90. When we will be calling a person hypertensive? In stage 1 hypertension, the systolic blood pressure usually lies between 140 to 159 mm of mercury, and diastolic blood pressure lies within the range of 90 to 99 mm of mercury. Stage 2 hypertension, the systolic blood pressure is 160 or above and the diastolic blood pressure is above 100. Let's talk about etiology. In majority of the cases, say around around 95% of the cases, a specific underlying cause for hypertension couldn't be found. So such condition is known as primary or essential or idiopathic hypertension. The pathogenesis of this condition is not clearly understood. Many factors may contribute to its development, as renal dysfunction, peripheral resistance vessel tone, endothelial dysfunction, peripheral or central adrenergic tone, insulin resistance, and various neurohumoral factors. Hypertension is more common in some ethnic groups, particularly Black Americans and Japanese, and approximately 40 to 60% of this could be explained by genetic factors. Important environmental factors includes a high salt intake, heavy consumption of alcohol, obesity, occupation, lack of exercise, family size, and overcrowding. Important to note, there is little convincing evidence that stress causes hypertension. In about 5% of the cases, hypertension can be due to a consequence of a specific disease or abnormality leading to sodium retention and peripheral vasoconstriction. Because it is secondary to a specific disease, we will be calling it as secondary hypertension. So secondary hypertension, mostly it is due to related to alteration in hormone secretion and some alteration in the renal function. In the clinical evaluation of hypertension, history assumes great importance. So while evaluating such patient, we have to take a detailed family history. A strong family history suggests association with essential hypertension. And lifestyle factors should also be evaluated, as exercise, the amount of salt intake, smoking habit, and other risk factors should also be recorded in history. Secondary hypertension often develops before 35 or after 55 years of age. History of repeated UTI can suggest chronic pyelonephritis. Important to note, use of oral contraceptive pills is an important cause of endocrine hypertension in females. So this is an important finding, and an MCQ might be framed on this important fact. History of weight gain is consistent with Cushing syndrome and weight loss with paroxysmal headache, palpitation and sweating suggests presence of pheochromocytoma. A careful history will identify those patients with drug or alcohol induced hypertension or complications such as coronary artery disease, which could be manifested as angina or breathlessness. Family history of early death due to cardiovascular disease is also a significant fact which has to be taken into consideration. As far as the physical examination is concerned, it starts with the general appearance of the patient. As the patient walks into your OPD chamber, general appearance as round face and truncal obesity could suggest a possible Cushing syndrome. Rise in diastolic BP when patient goes from supine to standing position is most commonly seen in essential hypertension or idiopathic hypertension. And a fall in diastolic BP when the patient goes from supine to standing position in absence of antihypertensive medication suggests that this could be secondary hypertension. You can find important signs as radiofemoral delay, which will give you an hint of coarctation of aorta. Abdominal bruise could tell you that there could be a possibility of renal artery stenosis. In renal artery stenosis, you might get a bruise in both the flanks if it is bilateral renal artery stenosis. And this stenotic renal artery could be due to fibrous dysplasia. And enlarged kidney could give you a hint of polycystic kidney disease. And these are all the examples of physical signs that may help to identify the cause for secondary hypertension. In the systemic examination, a third heart sound with pulmonary rails suggests ventricular dysfunction. You can get signs of left ventricular hypertrophy as apical heave. When you palpate the cardiac borders, you can get apical or heaving apex beat, accentuation of the aortic component of the second heart sound, and possibly you might also get a fourth heart sound. The optic fundi are often abnormal and there may be features of specific complications as aortic aneurysms or peripheral vascular disease. Examination may also reveal features of important risk factors such as central obesity and hyperlipidemia like tendon xanthomas, etc. Most abnormal signs in hypertension are usually seen as because of complication of hypertension. Why are we so scared of hypertension? As I already said, it is asymptomatic. It doesn't give you much problems except for a mild headache, which could be occipital, which patient feels. Normally, patient gets this occipital headache when he gets up in the morning, and usually it goes, it goes off, in say 2 to 3 hours. In most of the conditions, this could be asymptomatic, but it does a bad effect onto the body. It definitely damages the important organs, and this condition is known as target organ damage. So in hypertension, we are treating hypertension, or we are treating this elevated arterial pressure, so that this elevated arterial pressure should not damage the important organs. So that is why it is very important to understand that ultimately hypertension is causing target organ damage, and this is one strategy that we have to reduce the extent of damage as much as we can, and this can only be done when we are trying to get the blood pressure down by pharmacological or say by non-pharmacological or by pharmacological means. The adverse effects of hypertension on the organs can often be detected clinically, like what happens to blood vessels. In larger arteries, that is more than 1 mm in diameter, the internal elastic lamina is thickened. There is smooth muscle cell hypertrophy and fibrous tissues gets deposited. The vessels dilate and become tortuous, and importantly, their wall becomes inelastic and less compliant. Widespread atheroma develops, leading to narrowing of the artery, and this narrowing could lead to coronary or cerebrovascular diseases, particularly if other risk factors like smoking, hyperlipidemia, diabetes or long-standing hypertension if they are present. These structural changes in the vasculature often aggravate hypertension by increasing the peripheral vascular resistance, which is also known as the vascular tone. And this, because of this increased vascular tone, there is reduction in the renal blood flow. This reduction in the renal blood flow leads to activation of important renin-angiotensin-aldosterone axis due to decreased perfusion of the renal tissue. Please try to understand, whenever there is stenosis, this leads to compromise, this leads to reduction in the renal blood flow, and this leads to activation of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone axis due to decreased perfusion of renal tissues. Circulating angiotensin 2 level elevates arterial pressure by direct vasoconstriction. Sodium retention along with stimulating the adrenergic nervous system. Hypertension is a major risk factor in pathogenesis of aortic aneurysm and aortic dissection. Let's talk about what happens to central nervous system. As I've already said, occipital headaches, most often in the morning, are common early symptoms seen in hypertension. Dizziness, vertigo, diminished vision, and syncope can occur, but more serious manifestations are due to occlusion of an artery, hemorrhage, or encephalopathy. Stroke is a common complication of hypertension and may be due to a cerebral hemorrhage or infarction. Carotid atheroma and transient ischemic attacks are more common in hypertensive patients. Subarachnoid hemorrhage is also associated with hypertension due to elevated arterial pressure, and this could be because of development of a cerebral aneurysm. What happens to retina? The optic fundi, it reveals a gradation of changes which is linked to the severity of hypertension. Fundoscopy can therefore provide an opportunity to observe the progress of vascular effects of hypertension, because during fundoscopy, this is one place in our body where we can directly visualize the arterioles. So we'll be able to see changes which are occurring as the hypertension is progressing. So fundoscopy can provide an opportunity to observe the progress of vascular effect of hypertension. Increasing severity of hypertension can lead to focal spasm and progressive narrowing of the arterioles. There could be cotton wool exudates which are associated with retinal ischemia or infarction, and this fades in few weeks. Heart exudates, which are small, white, dense deposit of lipid, and microaneurysms, which are also known as hemorrhages, can point towards diabetic retinopathy. So this part is important, dot hemorrhages, which can give you a clue regarding diabetic retinopathy. And importantly, hypertension is also associated with central retinal vein thrombosis. Now let's see what hypertension does to heart. The excess cardiac mortality and morbidity associated with hypertension are largely due to higher incidence of coronary artery disease. High blood pressure places a pressure load onto the heart, and this may lead to concentric left ventricular hypertrophy with a forceful apex beat and possibly a fourth heart sound. Ultimately, function of this chamber deteriorates and signs and symptoms of heart failure appears. Electrocardiographic or echocardiographic evidence of left ventricular hypertrophy is highly predictive of cardiovascular complications, and therefore they are particularly useful in risk assessment. Atrial fibrillations is common, and this may be due to diastolic dysfunction caused by concentric left ventricular hypertrophy or the effects of coronary artery disease. Angina may also occur due to accelerated coronary arterial disease, and because there is left ventricular hypertrophy, so there is increase in myocardial muscle mass. So this increase in muscle mass may require more amount of oxygen. So there is imbalance between the supply and demand, and this can give rise to attack of angina. Severe hypertension can cause left ventricular failure in the absence of coronary artery disease, particularly when renal function is impaired. If the renal functions are impaired, then chances of salt reabsorption is more, and so in this condition, a patient might develop signs and symptoms of left ventricular failure. The sound of aortic closure is accentuated, and there may be a faint murmur of aortic regurgitation, and a third heart sound may be present. Majority of the death due to hypertension, it results from myocardial infarction or congestive cardiac failure. Let's say what kidney has to do if there is hypertension. Arteriosclerotic lesions of the afferent and the efferent arteriole and the glomerular tufts, capillary tufts, are the most common lesion which is seen in cases of hypertension. This may result in decreased glomerular filtration rate and tubular dysfunction. Long-standing hypertension may cause proteinuria, microscopic hematuria, and progressive renal failure by damaging the renal vasculature. Importantly, 10% of the death secondary to hypertension, it results from renal failure. So this is an important factor which you should keep in mind. Spiral CT scans with IV contrast CT angiography. I repeat, spiral CT scans with IV contrast CT angiography is a sensitive test for screening of renovascular hypertension. Quite a few MCQ has been asked on this question. What is the most sensitive test for screening of renovascular hypertension? So if the option given is spiral CT scan with IV contrast CT angiography, this has to be ticked. Nowadays, magnetic resonance angiography is most preferred. If in the MCQ you find an option as magnetic resonance angiography, so this is the most accurate answer. Because it is preferred nowadays, as it brings down the chances of contrast induced nephrotoxicity, and it also avoids exposure to ionizing radiations. So nowadays, magnetic resonance angiography, if a person has access to this, is the most sensitive test for screening of renovascular hypertension. Now, because we are talking about renal artery stenosis, and when I was browsing through MCQs, I have seen that quite a few MCQs has been asked on renal artery stenosis. So I thought again it would be prudent if I can just put few facts so that you'll be able to answer the MCQs. Atherosclerotic occlusive disease is the most common cause of renal artery stenosis. In the MCQ, they can ask what is the most common cause for renal artery stenosis. It is the atherosclerotic occlusive disease. Non-specific aorto arteritis, that too most commonly Takayasu's arteritis, is the most common cause for renal artery stenosis in young adults in India. Again, this fact can be asked as an MCQ. The most common cause of renal artery stenosis in young women is fibromuscular dysplasia. In young adults, it is Takayasu's arteritis. Renal artery stenosis is bilateral in and around 50% of the cases only. Right? So chances of getting bilateral renal artery stenosis is around 50%. So this is again is to be taken care of. Acute renal failure or worsening of renal failure with ACE inhibitors gives a clue that the patient might be suffering from stenotic renal artery, and invariably this is bilateral renal artery stenosis. And renal artery stenosis is very rarely seen with polyarteritis nodosa. This is one fact which I have directly taken from an MCQ, that renal artery stenosis can be because of atherosclerosis, this could be because of fibromuscular dysplasia, this could be because of aorto arteritis, and fourth option is polyarteritis nodosa. Yes, there are some aorto arteritis which is seen in polyarteritis nodosa, but renal artery stenosis is uncommonly seen in PAN or polyarteritis nodosa. Now a few words about malignant or accelerated phase of hypertension. This rare conditions may complicate hypertension of any etiology and it is characterized by accelerated microvascular damage with necrosis in the walls of small arteries and arterioles, which is also known as fibrinoid necrosis, and by intravascular thrombosis. The diagnosis is based on evidence of high BP and rapidly progressive end organ damage such as retinopathy, which could be of grade 3 and 4 type, renal dysfunction, which could present in terms of excessive proteinuria, and or hypertensive encephalopathy. So it is high BP in presence of progressive end organ damage like retinopathy, renal dysfunction, or hypertensive encephalopathy, you will be calling it as malignant or accelerated phase of hypertension. Left ventricular failure may occur, and if this is untreated, death occurs within months. Now let's see what are the various investigations which we will be doing in case of hypertension. As I have said initially, that this condition can be diagnosed or detected very easily. Chest X-ray done to see is there any cardiomegaly, heart failure, aortic dilatation, or any signs and symptoms of coarctation of aorta, where you can see notching of ribs. Ambulatory BP recording to assess borderline or white coat hypertension. You must be knowing what is white coat hypertension. Whenever a doctor checks somebody's BP, and at times this BP is high, and when the patient goes home and when he does BP recording onto his own equipments, the BP is okay. So this condition is known as white coat hypertension, and such patients are more prone to develop cardiovascular disease. The risk is less than the patient those who have got established or sustained hypertension, but definitely the risk is more than the normotensive patients. So white coat hypertension lies in between of sustained hypertension and normotensive patients. Renal ultrasound can be done to detect the possible renal disease. Renal angiography to detect or confirm the presence of renal artery stenosis. This is the gold standard to diagnose renal artery stenosis, that is renal angiography. 24 hours urinary catecholamines can be done to detect possible pheochromocytoma. 24 hours urine test for urinary cortisol, and dexamethasone suppression test can be used to detect possible Cushing syndrome. A urinary cortisol level less than 1000 micrograms effectively rules out Cushing syndrome. Plasma renin activity and aldosterone has to be done to detect possible primary aldosteronism. The aldosterone concentration is high and plasma renin activity is low in primary aldosteronism, and this is unaffected by changes in the sodium balance. Now at the end, towards the end of my presentation, we will be talking in short about what are the drugs which we will be using in a case of hypertension. I will be not going in details, because I presume that the anti-hypertensive drug has already been covered in pharmacology. So I will be just touching upon them, and will try to highlight any clinical aspect or any point where an MCQ can be framed. As we all know, thiazides and other diuretics are most commonly and most extensively investigated members of this group. Thiazide is commonly used. Sodium diuresis, volume depletion and reduction in peripheral vascular resistance has been said as the possible mechanism how these drugs are acting. Thiazides may have adverse effects as hypokalemia, hyperuricemia, carbohydrate intolerance, and possibly hyperlipidemia. So in all these four conditions, you should not use thiazides. More potent loop diuretics such as furosemide 40 mg daily have few advantages over thiazides in the treatment of hypertension, unless there is substantial renal impairment or they are used in conjunction with an ACE inhibitor. And as we all know, and you will be knowing if you recall your knowledge of pharmacology, furosemide is generally not preferred because it has got very short duration of action. ACE inhibitors are very important class of drugs extensively used in treatment of hypertension. As you all know, they inhibit the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 by inhibiting the angiotensin converting enzyme. That's why they are known as angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. Enalapril 20 mg daily, ramipril 5 to 10 mg daily, or lisinopril 10 to 40 mg daily could be used. Please note, they should be used with particular care in patients with impaired renal functions or renal artery stenosis. Most likely renal artery stenosis, that too bilateral renal artery stenosis, because they can reduce the filtration pressure in the glomeruli and can precipitate renal failure. So bilateral renal artery stenosis is a contraindication for use of ACE inhibitor drugs. Importantly, electrolytes and creatinine should be checked before and after 1 to 2 weeks once you start with the ACE inhibitor therapy. Side effect includes first dose hypotension, cough, dry brassy cough is an important adverse effect which is seen with use of ACE inhibitor drugs, rash, hyperkalemia and renal dysfunction could occur. Few words about angiotensin receptor blockers. Please note, ACE inhibitor drugs are the drug of choice in hypertensive diabetic patient having proteinuria. ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers are the first choice drugs for management of hypertensive patients with diabetes. So, dear students, please note, if anywhere in our question or anywhere in your clinical practice, if you happen to see a patient who is hypertensive and diabetic, the first thing which should strike your mind is ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers should be the antihypertensive drug which should be given to such patients. So, I repeat, ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers are the first choice drugs for management of hypertensive patients with diabetes. They do not have any adverse effect on glucose metabolism as diuretics or thiazides have, and they also minimize the development of diabetic nephropathy by reducing renal vascular resistance and perfusion pressure. This is how they protect kidneys from the ill effects of diabetes. That's why they are the choice of drugs in hypertensive patients suffering from diabetes also. Irbesartan 150 to 300 mg daily or valsartan 40 to 160 mg daily can be given. These block the angiotensin type 2 receptor and they have similar effects to ACE inhibitors, but importantly they do not cause dry cough and they are better tolerated than ACE inhibitors. Calcium channel antagonists, the dihydropyridines like amlodipine or nifedipine, they are effective and they are usually well tolerated antihypertensive drugs that are particularly useful in older people. Now this is again in fact which you should take care of in your mind. So patient hypertensive with diabetes, ACE inhibitors, elderly patients, you should think in terms of calcium channel blockers. Side effect includes flushing, palpitations and fluid retention. The rate limiting calcium channel antagonist like diltiazem or verapamil can be useful when hypertension coexists with angina, but they can cause bradycardia, so you have to be cautious in their use. And the main side effect of verapamil is constipation. Beta blockers, these are no longer used as first line antihypertensive therapy except in patient which has got some other indication for use of beta blockers as angina. Metoprolol 100 to 200 mg daily, Atenolol 50 to 100 mg daily and Bisoprolol, they preferentially block cardiac beta 1 adrenoceptors and they do not act on beta 2 which are vasodilatory and bronchodilatory. So they are selective beta 1 blockers. Labetalol 200 mg to 2.4 grams daily in divided doses and Carbidolol are combined beta and alpha adrenoceptor antagonists which are sometimes more effective than pure beta blockers. So these are the drugs which are preferred. Labetalol can be used as an infusion in malignant phase hypertension. Other drugs which could be used are vasodilators. These include the alpha 1 adrenoceptor antagonists, that is alpha blocker as prazosin 0.5 to 20 mg daily in divided doses, doxazosin, and drugs that act directly on the vascular smooth muscles such as hydralazine or minoxidil. Side effect of all these vasodilators include postural hypertension, headache, tachycardia and fluid retention. Minoxidil also causes increased facial hair and therefore it is unsuitable for female patient. Whereas if somebody asks you for a use, minoxidil can be used in in topical alopecia for selective hair growth. But here minoxidil also causes increased facial hair and therefore it is not suitable to be used in female patients. Emergency treatment of accelerated phase or malignant hypertension. In accelerated phase hypertension, lowering BP too quickly may compromise tissue perfusion due to altered autoregulation and it can also lead to cerebral damage. This could lead to occipital blindness and may precipitate coronary or renal insufficiency. So please note that we should not lower BP too quickly if the patient is suffering from malignant hypertension. Even in presence of cardiac failure or hypertensive encephalopathy, a controlled reduction to a level of about 150 to 90 mm of mercury over a period of 24 to 48 hours is ideal. So please note that whenever you get a case of accelerated hypertension, please do not think of bringing the BP down too quickly. This could be lethal to the patient. In most patients, it is possible to avoid parenteral therapy and we can get BP under control with bed rest or oral drug therapy. intravenous or intramuscular labetalol, intravenous glycerol trinitrate, intravenous hydralazine, and intravenous sodium nitroprusside. See, all I have made with red because all these are options which could be used in treatment of malignant hypertension, very commonly asked MCQ again. So all these drugs, they are very effective, but they require careful supervision, preferably in a high dependency unit or in an ICU setup. What is hypertensive crisis? Systolic BP of more than 180 mm of mercury and diastolic BP of 120 mm of mercury along with evidence of active end organ damage is labeled as hypertensive emergency, and if the elevation is same without the signs and symptoms of organ damage, we will be calling it as a hypertensive crisis. In hypertensive emergency, controlled BP reduction is required within minutes, that is within an hour, and in hours in urgency. So if there is active organ damage, we will be calling it as hypertensive emergency, and if the BP is high without the involvement of end organ damage, we will be calling it as hypertensive urgency. Now, rapid reduction of blood pressure is required in clinical conditions like accelerated malignant hypertension with peptidema, aortic dissection, hypertensive encephalopathy, intracerebral hemorrhage, pheochromocytoma crisis, food or drug interaction with MAO inhibitors. Please note, in all these conditions, we need to do a rapid reduction in blood pressure because they are all causes of hypertensive emergencies. Final slide, or I think the second last slide. What are the drugs which are used in hypertensive crisis? IV for emergencies and oral for urgencies. IV, we have sodium nitroprusside, nitroglycerin or hydralazine, as I already said. In adrenergic inhibitor group, we can use phentolamine or labetalol. In diuretics, IV furosemide could be used, and in ACE inhibitor category, enalaprilat can be used. You know that enalapril is a prodrug, it gets converted into enalaprilat, which is the active drug. So this enalaprilat IV can be used in treatment of hypertensive emergencies. Oral for hypertensive urgencies, we have nifedipine, but please note, nifedipine once upon a time was very commonly used, but nowadays we are not using nifedipine for control of hypertensive urgencies. Labetalol is the drug of choice, or we can use hydralazine, clonidine or nicardipine. The last and the final slide is, when I was again going through some of the MCQs, I just saw that they have asked certain MCQs as though which of the following combinations should be avoided in hypertension. So I just thought it would be prudent again to add a slide on that. These are the drug combination which is to be avoided in hypertension. Low dose diuretic and a calcium channel blocker as nifedipine, as there is no synergy, so there is no point in adding these two. Beta blockers and verapamil or diltiazem, this can give rise to severe bradycardia. Beta blocker and ACE inhibitor is also not recommended to be combined, and ideally we should not combine two drugs from the same class. So these are the combinations which are to be avoided once you are planning a drug therapy for treatment of hypertension. Thank you.